Can you hear me now? Yes. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. It's a summery sort of feel to this late winter's afternoon. We're in the middle of the Kruger National Park, and you're watching Safari Live.
Ready.
Standing by.
You are live. Sorry about that slight glitch there at the beginning, everybody. Like I say, it's a very pleasant afternoon out. 29 degrees, I'm told, about 84 degrees Fahrenheit or so. One day I'll be able to remember those without having to stumble over my words every time I have to say them. The light is very white today. My name is James Henry. On camera today is David. Hello, David.
Hello, James.
Yeah, it's very nice to be back with you, of course. You've been away, wassailing around the world.
Indeed.
On the other vehicle, a special treat, everybody. We have Stefan Winterboer, the Mystic Boer, full in front of camera today. And if you look very carefully at the thumb of his cameraman, Gracie, aged 9 in Ohio, you'll see one specially designed for you. We are going to go, David and I, that is, and therefore all of you, we're going to go off to the far west, drive down the western boundary of Djuma, see if there are any leopard tracks that way, and then we're going to do the southern boundary and see the same. The idea, because I really want to see Karula's little babies. I haven't seen them for a very long time, so it would be good to see them again. That is my plan. Steph, I think, is going to go around the northern side and see what he can find that way. It's been a hot day, so hopefully lots of elephants, but we'll see as the afternoon unfolds. Lovely to have you with us. Please do talk to us, hashtag Safari Live or questions at WildEarthTV. Anton, hello, you're a new viewer. And you say, what is this? Well, Anton, some might describe it as a circus. Some might describe it as a great hodgepodge of eccentricity tossed into the middle of nowhere. But most would describe it as the world's largest safari vehicle. And basically, you're on a live game drive. We're in the northeast corner of South Africa. That is the world's most beautiful country, unquestionably. And we're on the western fringes of the iconic Kruger National Park. And what we're going to be doing is driving around for the next 3 hours or so, and we do this twice a day, hoping to find the various animals that come around. We don't know what is where, because this is an enormous wildlife area of 8.5 million acres, as I said. And so, Anton, don't go anywhere, stay where you are, and hopefully we'll have some wonderful things to show you. While I go off to the west, heading off to the north and east, the great Stefan Winterboer, let's go and say hello to him.
Good afternoon, and yes, I'm actually in a car. I didn't quite know what to do with this steering wheel and all these buttons and pedals when I first got into the car, and thank goodness for James for actually saying hello to you, because I think I would have crashed the car. But yes, I am on the car. We are driving today. Brian is on the camera, and we have a flyby. There we go.
Dragon thumb for you, Gracie. Hope you like it.
That's it. In case you didn't catch that, that was a dragon thumb for you, Gracie. Brian hopes you like it. Took him all of the half a day to draw that. He's been trying out various designs, and he finally settled on one that is actually quite cool, as far as I'm concerned, at least anyway. We are heading down Twin Dams, and we are going to go and look at the watering points. It's been a very, very hot day today. And look what we have here. Now try and get me out of the way here. Wait, I think what's going to be easier. Sorry, Brian. Rather than fight my head out of the way. I'm constantly berated for the way that my shiny bald head gets in the way of all these nice shots for you. So we've got some kudu here. This is a small breeding herd of kudu, and I say breeding herd because of the presence of a youngster. But this is what you're looking at now. That's a full-grown female. all 500, no, not quite, about 300 pounds of female. And there you have the babies and the rest of the herd, made up of females, immature males, and then little calves like you're looking at now. That's a, it's about a 1.5-year-old calf. New brothers and sisters to be born in January. Most of the females that you're looking at are heavily pregnant. This one was born probably about 1.5 years ago now. You can see the overgrown feet, basically, and legs, not feet, overgrown legs for that skinny little neck and head. That is a giveaway. Very difficult to actually gauge just looking at a single animal, but coming now into your screen from the right will be a full-grown female, and you can see that her neck and head are a little bit more in proportion to those legs, followed by another calf behind her. And some Impala photobombing the chute. A young Impala, well, Kudus. I love Kudus. They're one of the most graceful of the antelope out here. And we have a young male Impala. You can see from those straight up horns that he's got there. Those horns haven't started to get that characteristic bend or lyre shape to them. And that is because he was born literally about 1 year ago. The Impala get born in about November, December time. And they all get born at the same time. And it creates a bit of a glut amongst the predators here, and more babies survive into adulthood that way. And it's actually a very effective strategy, to be honest. They're more Impala in the Kruger National Park than any of your other large mammals. They've got an incredibly effective breeding structure in that sense. They're able to utilize both grass and plant matter, and so, or plant and leaf matter, and so their diet is hugely variable, which allows them some adaptation. They are supreme at keeping open areas open. Now, for years, scientists thought that elephants were responsible for open areas, but in actual fact, lately it's swinging towards them believing that Impala are the ones that keep it open. So an elephant will move into an area and clear a stand of trees, or elephants would move into an area and clear a stand of trees. Impala would then immediately populate that open area and keep growth from happening, thus creating this open area. Not much past that is understood. I mean, it's obvious that less trees and more sunlight promotes grass. On the fringes of these particular open areas, you'll have some of your more protein-rich grasses, or your climax grasses, and then in the middle of these open areas, you'll start to get your subclimax grasses, but they make quite good hay material. So I don't know, I think at the second and third layer down on these levels, it starts to get so complicated with so many variables playing or interplaying with one another, it's difficult to actually see what is good and what is bad. There's no doubt that pumped watering holes have had a dramatic increase in, or have had a dramatic effect on the increase in population numbers. But far from having the dramatic decrease in population numbers when these dams have been closed, it seems to have done nothing to the Impala numbers. They seem to be quite capable of existing without water, which adds another variable that's difficult to decide. What is actually causing these Impala numbers to increase? No one really, really knows. That's the wonderful thing about the Kruger National Park, is that nobody knows anything, really, if you take that standpoint. And constant study is needed to understand all these different levels and all these different systems that are going and playing against one another and interplaying with one another and are reliant on one another. And if you ask the Kruger National Park, if you ask any of the old scientists that come through here, almost to a man or to a woman will tell you that after 40 years in this industry, they know less than they did when they started. And I'm sure that can be said for many of us. Now, I'd like to bid a warm welcome to Hugo, who's a brand new viewer to Safari Live. So welcome aboard, Hugo, and I hope to share some of the questions with you, with the rest of our audience, ongoing. So don't stop them coming. But as your first question as a Wild Earth and Safari Live viewer, you've wanted to know how often or how common it is to see sable in the Kruger National Park. It is uncommon to see sable in the Kruger National Park. There are only around about 350 sable in the Kruger National Park in an area that's roughly 3.5 million hectares big. You're looking at about 8 or 9 million acres. So 350 individual animals is, to start with, a low number. However, this portion of the Sabi Sand Game Reserve, which is adjacent to the Kruger National Park, but with a common boundary and no fence, i.e. animals can move from one place to another, sees its fair share of sable. And we last saw a sable, I don't know, Brian, less than 6 months ago. I think it was at the onset of the dry season a couple of months ago. We had a lone sable bull come in from the Kruger National Park, come right up to Vuyatelapan, and then make his way back into the Kruger National Park. And there have been a variety of different reports across the Nkoro and Cheetah Plains, two of our nearby adjacent properties that we one of them, Cheetah Plains, we can traverse on Nkoro we can't, but they're right next to one another, of sable coming in and onto their open areas in front of their lodge during the evenings. And then I know Mala Mala has a semi-permanent sort of herd of sable that that live on their Kruger National Park Mala Mala boundary. So within a very small area, we do have sable here, but we don't see them that many times a year, because there are just only 350 of them. So nice question there. Not as common as I've seen sable in other places in the park. I would say that the northern end of Botswana, around Kasani town, there's a game reserve there that borders Namibia and Namibia and Botswana. And I've definitely seen a lot of sable there. And then in Zambia, I've seen portions of game reserves there that have a lot of sable. But on that note, I think we're going to go through to, and we'll leave you with a view of this kudu. He's actually just right next to the car. And we're going to send you over to James.
Everybody, we've turned on to Arathusa Terra Incognito to the west. We're hoping to find, I don't know really. I got some distressing news while we were off air, everybody. Karula and her babies are on Chitwa. Thank you, James Richard, for ruining my afternoon. So now we are going to have to find Tingana or Shadow if we want to see leopards. Alternatively, I don't know, we might find something else. We're going towards Red Dam, because of course, sorry Davy, I'm just reversing because I thought that tree looked a bit thick, like there might be a leopard lurking in the top of it. You know what I mean? No, I don't think there is. I think it's just a bit of tree that looks a bit like another bit of tree. It is not a leopard in the tree. Okay, so my plan then is we're going to go to Red Dam here. We'll follow the line of the great, what's this drainage line called again? It's the Marakeni drainage line, there we go. We'll go to the west of Arathusa, down the other side, and back out and see what we can find on the way there. Which reminds me, I must change the radio channel so that I might hear what the people at Arathusa and Elephant Plains and Simbambili have to say to us. So for those of you who are new viewers, for example Anton, who was wondering what on earth he was watching, Anton, we operate on 6,500 acres or so, 2,500 hectares, and one of the pieces of land that we use is this one called Arathusa. It's 800 hectares in extent, in acres that is. It's always so difficult to work out, 2,000 acres. And then off to the far east is Cheetah Plains, which we're not going to go to this afternoon because we're over here. And Elephant Plains, who I've just mentioned, is the other side of this, Simbambili to the north, and they all traverse the same piece of land. So they have their own radio channel, and that's why I have to change the channel so that we can hear them. And if they find something nice, then we can go and have a look. And if we find something nice, then we'll call them, and they might decide to come and have a look as well. And that's basically how it works. It's quite clever, really. Right, there's a waterhole up ahead. There's been a hippopotamus living in it for the last little while. Sort of sub-optimal hippopotamus territory. It's very, very bright out here at the moment. I'm trying to figure out, I think we're changing the times again, if I'm not mistaken. I stand a correction here. on the 1st of September, is that correct? But not in the evening. Or is it in the evening? I don't remember. Yeah, we will probably change the evening one. Yes, I thank you, Rebecca. I realized the morning one had already changed. This I realized, of course, because I've been taking the morning one for the last little while. Now, the evening one will probably change to half an hour later, just after the 1st of spring, which is the 1st of September. And so it'll be slightly softer light as we go out. But it is getting quite harsh. And you'll notice that we don't even take the spotlight out at the moment, at the end of drive. Ah, there is a hippopotamus, David, and he has a friend. He has a friend called Thomas the Terrapin. There he is. This is just a special shout out to all our new viewers to say, please do just tell us you're watching. It's lovely to have you with us, and tell us where you're watching from. It's always a good thing to know where in the world we're watching from, and that is not to in any way cast any kind of aspersion on our regular viewers. It's obviously great to have you along too. Without you and without your constant conversation, well, this kind of thing just couldn't exist, could it? And there he is. You can just see his ears and eyes poked out the water, keeping an eye out and an ear out for anything that might interest him, or more importantly, threaten him. So like I say, it's quite hot out here. That is a serrated hinged terrapin, everybody. And the serrated hinged terrapin is a reptile, obviously. Perhaps not so obviously, but he is a reptile, which means that because he spends all the time in the water, especially on a winter's day like today, and it was pretty cold this morning, in fact it was pretty cold until fairly late on, because of that he has to come out into the sun to warm up, otherwise his body just simply doesn't function properly. And so he's come out onto what he probably thinks is a bit of a rock to sun himself. Something else of vital importance I wanted to tell you about that terrapin, but I've now completely forgotten what it was. Never mind, it obviously wasn't that important. Oh yes, I do remember now. Many of you would have seen the oxpeckers, and I wonder if you didn't see some oxpeckers with Steph, with the Kudu and the Impala he was showing you. Many of you will know that the oxpeckers eat the ticks off the land mammals, and these serrated hinged terrapins do the same kind of thing. They act as sort of water-bound oxpeckers. There's an oxpecker on the top of the hippo. Look at that. Two of them. That is very cool. And they're not actually eating any ticks off him. They've decided that they're going to have a drink of water. Isn't that cool?
Excuse me.
That is very cool, actually. They're not eating anything off him, they're just bathing in the water, using him as a rock in exactly the same way that the terrapin is. And now one's having a perfunctory peck or two to see if there's any blood in the offing, because that's what they're looking for. Blood. Vampirous birds. And they're all red-billed oxpeckers. Not to be confused with the yellow-billed variety. Oh, they're flying off. Why did they fly off? Hot has caused them consternation. I don't see any raptors. And I'm just going to be quiet for 1 second, or not 1 second, slightly more than that, maybe 10 seconds. Just have a listen and see what you can hear. Now the reason, of course, that one can't be quiet for longer than 10 seconds in an atmosphere like this is that you would go to sleep if you were quiet for more than 10 seconds. you might just have been able to hear a couple of Egyptian geese going quietly sort of hissing at each other. Perhaps you heard the blacksmith lapwing going tink, 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 as he foraged a little bit around the side of this pan. But otherwise, just a very gentle northeasterly breeze. Marvellous. All righty, let's head along. Then we're going to go into the Marikeni drainage. Hello, Mia. You're 4 years old, and it's good to hear from you again before we just roll quietly into this water. Mia, you want to know why the water is green? Mia, it's something called algae, which is a special kind of a creature, I suppose you could say. It's not quite a plant. It's not an animal either. And it likes to grow in the top of water, water that doesn't have any chemicals in it, and so that's why it's green. It's the same reason as your pool will go green, or a pool will go green, if you don't put any chlorine in it. And chlorine is the special stuff that keeps it clean. The hippo will get dirty, but that's fine. He's supposed to be a little bit dirty. That's how he stays cool. It's how his skin stays protected from the sun. Righty, now, just around the... Whoa, David, there's a bit of a sinkhole there. Yes. Just around the corner here, there is the great Marikeni River, and we shall go into it and see what delights lie in the deep shade. But before we do that, there is a zebra that just warrants our attention. There we go. That zebra is very impolite. It has not turned around at all to say hello to us. And again, you can just get a sense of the silence. You might be able to hear them just clicking their feet together, snorting like horses. There we go. And the slight tearing sound of the grass as they graze. Let me sneak forward. There's some others just up ahead. One's particularly brave, actually. Let's go around the corner here. I think that was the stallion that we were looking at, and I think these are his two wives, both of whom are probably pregnant. I don't see any others around here. And as I was saying this morning, I don't think these things are doing too badly. I don't think the drought's affected them that horribly at all. I think it's quite amazing. Only the elephants seem to look that sort of ropey. The rest are looking absolutely fine. Even the warthogs, which are supposed to be hit hard by these droughts, they seem to be fine too. Maybe in a month's time that will change if we haven't had rain. But I was chatting to Michael Grover, who of course does a lot of work with the communities outside, and he does a lot of work specifically with the cattle herders. And he said to me, I said, they must be looking terrible, the cattle, now. He said, no, not too bad. There was that little flush of rain that we had about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and apparently that did wonders for that little flush of green to come out of the grassy seedbed, and that really did help the cattle out here. And that's great, and I'm sure it had the same effect for the animals here. Righty, let us move along, David. Here we have arrived in the water. Hello, Gracie, age 9, you say, am I having a cold? I did have a bit of a cold, Gracie, but I'm okay now. I've just got a bit of a snoggy nose, so I'm sorry about that. But you say that you would give me orange juice and read me a story. Well, that sounds actually wonderful, Gracie, so I hope one day that you'll be able to do that to me. Great. Let's go across to Steph and see what he's doing, and I shall deal with my snoggy nose.
Well, I'm glad for you that you didn't have to watch James deal with his whatever he said nose. I didn't quite get that, and what's going through my mind, I choose not to repeat in polite company. And that's good. You've caught us sort of having done Twin Dams. Got to Twin Dams, not much going on there, a lot of activity, footprint activity in terms of hippopotamus from last night. No one had driven there this morning, but also no predator tracks on the road whatsoever, barring a civet, which we saw tracks of last night. So no real activity there. And so that makes me want to come and have a look at what's happening around Treehouse Dam. Because between Vuyatela or Djuma, Treehouse and Twin Dams, and with the wild card being Biffle's Hook, there's almost always something going on. And we don't always find it, but walking around here has taught me one thing about this particular property, in that there is almost always something of note happening here all the time. And it's just a question of a bit of luck and a little bit of hard work and perseverance, and quite often we can pull something relatively interesting, at least, out of the bag. So, I'm going to be circling these places. I think friend James has already gone and seen Biffle's Hook for us and switched off his car and was watching those terrapins having a drink off of the back of or near that hippopotamus, which gave him some time to listen to the bush around him. And I'm hoping that we have got some sighting of something small or interesting. James was at Red Dam, not at Biffle's Hook Dam. Okay, that leaves that whole area open for us to explore as well. Nice. Thank you very much for that, Rebecca. I think James actually did tell me, but I was only listening to with half an ear as I was busy trying to prep this vehicle and understand where my feet go and what radio works what. Right. So, what we need is we need a point of interest, Mr. Brian, so that I can stop, switch off, and while I'm busy talking to you, can dedicate some portion of my anatomy, my ears hopefully, and a little piece of brain capacity to listening to the bush around us. It's been hot today. Not much is going to be moving around at this time. That being said, I think predators are making the most of these. They're hot, it is hot, but relatively cool conditions, and the overabundance of prey animals in a weakened state. And I mean, just the sheer amount of kills that Karula has had in the last month alone just makes me just, it's astounding how these animals can capitalize on different things. Now, hold on, Brian, are you busy? I'm seeing if we can get this little bird. I want to go back just a little bit. There's a young starling. Let's go here. If we can get that orange eye, which is just spectacular. There you go. Much obliged to. Ah, I've got an angle issue. All right. Let's see if I can remedy that. How's that, Brian? Might just get his eye over the top there. Sorry, this is just one of those things. I think I've been a little bit over optimistic with this particular sighting. That is a blue-eared starling that you're having a look at there. Characteristic is that very orange eye in that iridescent sheen that they have on their feathers. And you can see that sheen evidence. Now, their feathers are actually completely black, completely saturated with a substance called melanin. And then unique to the starlings, I think, and potentially a few sunbirds, although these are probably some of the biggest iridescent birds that we find, where the whole bird is iridescent, not just portions of it. The bird has invested in a very thick layer of keratin. Now, keratin is similar to your hair or your fingernails. And that keratin layer
completely covers the feather, very thick covering, for lack of a better description, and that diffuses the light that goes through that feather, giving you that wonderful sheen, which has now disappeared off of your screen. Not to worry, it gave us the opportunity to switch off and to listen to the bush around us. Now this time of the day I'm expecting to hear things like the cracking of branches from elephant feeding, potentially the lowing of a buffalo, oxpeckers. On the off chance that you've got a predator hunting at the moment would be alarm calls of animals, alarm calls of squirrels, monkeys, impala, and kudu, so on and so forth. And I do absolutely know that leopard in this particular part of the world move around absolutely through the even the heat of the day. Ah. So Audrey, who's only 12 years old and asking this question all the way from the US. Hello, Audrey. You've asked me if we have the same squirrels as you have in the US, but you've noticed that the squirrels where you live don't sound the same as they do here. So Audrey, so the easy answer to your question is no, we don't have exactly the same squirrels, although all squirrels pretty much are related to one another. They probably have some or other type of common ancestor. So they all have that little curly tail. They are mainly daytime or diurnal animals. They all have a liking for storing food, and they're all relatively cute. Now we've got another bird here. Let's see if we can get let's see if we can go past. Now the trick with these birds is to let them believe that you haven't seen them. So obviously pointing a camera at them is going to make it a little bit more difficult, but have a look at the awesome camouflage of that bird. That is a bird called a thickney, and it gets its name thickney from its specific name, and why it's called a thickney escapes me. I have in all the years of watching these birds never understood why they're called thickneys, but this bird is a water thickney. We get two different types in this particular part of South Africa. We get the water and the spotted thickney. This is the water thickney, and is almost always associated to pans and to dams and to water courses all over the place. They are nocturnal, and because they are nocturnal, they have this enormous eye. Brian, there's another one closer to us even here, underneath the, on the right-hand side of this bush. There we go. They live in pairs, sometimes more than that, and have a look at that. That is just, take a screenshot, everybody. That is about as good as what you can get a water thickney. There we go. Boom. Nicely done. All right. All of you that might have been a little bit slow off of the mark, absolutely share those pictures on any of our social media platforms, and you're welcome to email your photos through to questions@wildearth.tv. And I'm not sure if, you know, never having been on Twitter, I don't really know if you can share photos on Twitter. If you can, use the hashtags for love and see what you can do. Well, there you go. So you sure can share photos on Twitter. You'd never say that working for such a technologically advanced company such as Wild Earth Media that I wouldn't have a social media presence, but I don't. I've never been on Twitter or Instagram. I wouldn't even know what their homepage looks like. All right. So, onwards with our search for something interesting. Water at this time of the year and leading into October, and in any parts of Southern Africa that you go to, water equals life. Where you find water, you find life. And even though food becomes a very, very difficult thing to find, and eventually becomes impossible to find, animals will always be more water biased than they will be food biased. And I'll explain that in a second. We've got, there we go. As usual, the grey dacre diving away into the bushes over there, one of the dwarf antelope, and they very rarely actually stop and give you the ability to even zoom in on them. Steenbok, on the other hand, will race off and then stop and give you a chance sometimes. Duiker absolutely don't. So one of the dwarf antelope that we have out here, the common or grey Duiker, as you get into Central Africa, the different Duiker species become... There you go. We just caught that one through the gap there. Let's see if we can get... There you go. Nice one, Brian. Well done. Caught him, caught her in a little bit of a moment, and I think that's precisely why we are managing to get these shots. I have no doubt once finished, dash off. There we go. Boom, 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 those jinx. All right. Alrighty, let's send you through to James. He's got a vulture for you.
Not a Duiker, everybody. Death in the sky. Sorry, I've been very tempted to use that term ever since Brent Leo Smith used it once when to describing the humble lizard buzzard. Not death in the sky. I thought there might be some kind of death on the ground underneath these chaps, but there isn't. Those are two white-backed vultures, the most common vulture species that we get here. And they, I'm not really sure what they're doing, really. I think they're just resting up. There's one other, not too far from here, but I think it's on a nest. And I wonder if one of these isn't an offspring and the other partner. They're quite splendid birds. I mean, that's an enormous fellow. Let me tell you how big he is. Give me 1 second. Everyone's starting to get a mobile now from Elephant Plains and from Arathusa and from Simbambali. Let me just quickly tell you. So he's three and a bit feet tall, everyone. So I mean, he's almost 3'3". So that's a fairly large bird. Weighs about 11 pounds or so, 5.5 kilograms. And his wingspan, I always find the wingspan interesting, 2.2 meters. Now 2.2 meters is about 8 feet or so. Not quite. About 7.5 feet. So that is quite impressive. And it is the most common vulture by far that we get out here. And quite sweetly they are monogamous, building a very uncomfortable looking stick platform, often in the crown of a tree. But if I was a little bird and I was born to the uncomfortableness that is a vulture's nest, I feel I would be disappointed with my lot in life. Not for them, the gentle spider-lined cup that is the want of, say, the white-crowned shrike, which makes a most comfortable nest, and nest certainly nothing like the comfort of the nest of the grey penduline tit, which makes it a sort of an astoundingly woven, incredible, sort of intricately constructed sack of, yeah, I think it's largely spiders' webs. And the chicks in there must be very comfortable indeed. I suppose there's a certain amount of health involved in growing up in a stick nest. No, not so much lice around the place. And likewise, you grow up tough, you know. Like growing up in a bad neighborhood, David. Makes you tough. So I am so tough. Right, let's leave our white-backed vultures. We're going to do an about turn. We just came out of the drainage line to the northern side in the hopes of seeing what they were looking at. But I think they're actually just looking towards another vulture, which is in a nest. So let's turn around here. And we'll see what else we can see. We did find some hyena tracks, but tracking hyenas is like tracking the world's fastest marathon runner. They go so very far with so little effort that it's not a great idea. There's a big hyena den on Elephant Plains, everybody, and I wish we could go to it because I'm so missing our hyenas. I don't know where they've gone. No one seems to have found their den. So it's rather sad. They gave us such an immense amount of joy going to their den sites every day. These things go in cycles, they do. Otherwise, we did also see some kudu. They were feeding inside the drainage. But other than that, not much. Hello, Aaron. You want to know if we get spur-winged geese here? Yes, we do get spur-winged geese, Aaron. I've seen a few here. They do need water, though, so normally we'll only see them if there's good amounts of water. So absolutely, you could see them all over Djuma, all over Cheetah Plains, as and when the rains come. You'll find them at the bigger water points, definitely, Aaron, yeah. The spur-winged goose, of course, the very largest goose that is found in this area. An enormous fellow, but greenish.
Sometimes all that you can do is leave decisions in the road up to chance, and that's exactly what we did here. I literally left the steering wheel alone and felt which way I was compelled to go at that particular junction, and we were compelled to go left for some unbeknownst reason. And left is where we'll go. Now, while James finds some new signal, you're going to be on another portion of our endless search for something interesting to show you out here. A little bit of, well, we've had a few impala around, birds are going crazy, we've had some dwarf mongoose that have made an appearance while you were looking at this interesting vulture activity that you had. Nothing too much. Oh, and we had the kudus when we opened up the show as well. There's some kudus. So things are moving around. I mean, even while I'm driving here, to be honest, in the shade, so let me get in the shade there, in the shade and in the wind, it's probably easily 10 degrees colder than out in the open. So it's not actually that hot today. Now, we were talking about the fact that animals will always be more water biased than they are food biased, and that is almost a universal truth. So where there's water in the dry times of the year leading up to and just past October, water is exactly where we need to be concentrating our searches, because animals can go a decent amount of time without food but cannot go long periods of time without water. There's a generalization: 3 minutes without oxygen, 3 days without water, 3 weeks without food. That's a general generalization. And so you can see that even though they've got a little bit of food, they can still do a long time relatively compared to them not being able to get access to water. And in places like the Chobe National Park, elephants literally wait for the rain on the Chobe River. So the entire month of October, the rains normally only come in the last week of October, somewhere around there. Entire month of October, elephants in their tens of thousands sit on the side of the Chobe River and pretty much just stay hydrated, and if they can, in a bit of the shade, but even that is secondary to their need for water. Now, while I've been chatting, I've been doing a bad thing and not talking about what you're having a look at. And what you're having a look at here is two impala rams, evidenced by their horns, busy doing a bit of a dance around one another. I'm not quite sure exactly why, and it's one of the reasons why it's taken me so long to actually answer what we're looking at. When I did stop, they were twinkle-toesing around one another. Now, the larger of the two males seems to be walking away, and he's followed. There he goes. So now he's just turned around and he's gone again back to this male, posturing. That side-on display in front of the other male impala is a very deliberate move called posturing. And there he's posturing again, walking right up into his face, showing the other impala how long his horns are and how beautiful his body is. Other male impala can't help but to respond by turning to face the other male. There we go, the obligatory head shake. Now, this time of the year is not the impala's rut. That happens in about May. And so I think that this is just them practicing, to be quite honest. I don't think there's any serious intent here at all. It's not to say just because it's not in the rut time doesn't mean that boys don't fight. As you'd all know, boys have this tendency to want to scuffle and wrestle with one another. And even if it's not that serious, it definitely will be practice for when it does become serious. And that impala on the left-hand side with the big horns will be big enough next year to actually challenge any of the dominant male impala in this area for dominance over a herd and mating rights, obviously, that come with that. I think let's see if we can go a little bit more forward, or is this good for you, Brian? This is all good. There you go, that ritual that they're going through at the moment, facing one another, a little bit of a lip licking, that yawning, nodding, tails flicking, then all of a sudden the distracted stare out into the distance. That's all part of this whole dance that impala do with one another. One backing off, one advancing, tails wagging. I know it may seem like I'm just talking about what I'm witnessing here, but that is all actually part of this dance that they do with one another. And then one trying to walk away, and then they'll reset again. And they'll do this on and off. No animal really... Oh, there we go. Okay, so maybe it is a bit more serious. Gee whiz. Well, that is a proper fight. That's amazing. They're having a decent fight. Have a look at that. Now other males coming in from the sides, looking to add any advantage they can. Look at that. That is a deathly fight. They've got their horns locked, pushing those ridges against one another, using their powerful back legs. You can see them kicking out those back legs, trying to hold down. There you've got the one trying to push the horns into the body cavity of the other one. They're now locked with one another. One will have to disengage. That'll open the neck and the chest cavity for a thrust. Those horns wickedly sharp. Have a look at the power there. This is incredible. This is probably the longest impala fight I've ever seen in my 20 years of guiding. Look at them pushing each other around. Other impala in the periphery. And there they break. They're locked again. Let's give them some space. Every nerve in my body is telling me go forward. Whoa, that was a big thrust. You saw that one impala lift right up into the air there. That is quite capable of killing that impala. So let's just look for some blood. Looks like he may just have been picked up on the horns. Look at that. See the one, now he's got the leverage advantage. Leverage advantage, which will twist the horn. There we go. I can actually see I have no blood just yet. They're just pushing against one another. There we go. And there's the winner. And there you had it. So the one that ran off in the front, he was the loser. The one that chased, he was the victor. Now I would love in the next couple of minutes to have a look at that, to re-look at that again and see at what point in those last couple of seconds the winner or the loser was decided there. I've got a feeling probably went back 20 or 30 seconds or so to where you saw that other impala have the leverage and was twisting that head to the side. And what happens is as they're busy fighting with one another, the one impala will try and twist to the side, and then that is the death strike. Right here in the side of the neck or into the body cavity behind the armpit here. That is where impala that I've seen dead from fighting like that, that is the death strike. In the side of the neck and the other horn usually in underneath the armpit. Wasn't that amazing to see? That was probably the best impala fight I've ever seen. I certainly see Brian's face smiling over there. Sighting of the week so far for us, absolutely. All right, so on that note, and because I want to go and see what's happening over there, and we don't really know where those impalas are, we're going to send you over to James. We'll catch up with you a little bit down the road.
Hello, everybody. We're searching for the magnificent bird that is the long-billed Crombec. David had him perfectly in picture, but then he decided that he was very camera shy, and as Rebecca started to count us in, he thought, to hell with this, and off he flew. And there was also a cardinal woodpecker. I know this sounds like long, tall stories to you, but really there was a cardinal woodpecker somewhere in there. David, I'm going to make the call of the long-billed Crombec and let us see if we can't attract him back. Come on, Crombec, where are you? Yes, there, top of the tree there, top of the tree. I think David may have just broken his knee, everybody. Let me go back a bit. Can you see him? He's just very, very top of the tree there. On the right-hand side, you got him. So, you see the closest bit to us? Just to the right of that, there's another little bit, and he's just in the middle there. So if you, that's him, you got him. Up, up, up. That's it. You got him. Now that's not very nice of us to do to him, everybody, but we wanted to see him, so we'll be okay. There he is, the long-billed Crombec. He too is monogamous, everyone. And he makes a beautiful nest, a hanging sort of purse. But he is parasitized by one of the cuckoos, the classless cuckoo. He's quite special, isn't he? And he's called long-billed because he has a slightly long bill, I suppose. But mostly, his most obvious thing is that he does not have a tail. You see that? He's got almost no tail at all. He's deeply confused as to what on earth was shouting. And they eat it with that long bill like that. The big thing for them to eat, of course, are invertebrates. Insects, termites, spiders, mantids, the odd tick, the odd insect egg even, apparently. And they like grapes. I've just read that, I didn't remember that. They like grapes, everybody. The long-billed Crombec, a sophisticated palate, enjoys a little bit of Shiraz of an evening. On those wonderful colours, the grey and the blue, with a little bit of sort of, what would you describe that as, sort of, I don't know, pale tawny. That really is a lovely array of colours then. You can just see the buds of the marula tree coming out there, that's really special as well. And there's another one calling now, and that's why he's looked round. There, he's getting upset. He's flown down. Oh, he's right here. He's in that same bush that we started out at, but he's gone into some very thick stuff there, so I think we'll probably leave him. Rather than challenge David too much this early into his work cycle. Very nice. The long-billed Crombec. Right. We're approaching Arathusa Mud Wallow. Used to be known as Arathusa Dam. No longer. David, have you been here since you've been back from leave? Oh, you're in for a shock. There ain't no water here anymore, David. It's just a bit of mud. A couple of fish eagles. Oh, I don't know if there are any fish eagles here anymore. They may have completed all of the catfish by now. Let's have a look-see. I must say, Arathusa is very dry at the moment. They don't pump much water here, which I think is a very brave decision on their part. There is a slender mongoose, though. We're not going to get him from here, though. There's a fish eagle flying away. Did you see it there? There are two of them there. I didn't see them early enough, so they took fright. Two juvenile fish eagles. Got a lovely picture of one the other day. I haven't shown my greatest photography critic yet, that is David, my picture of the fish eagle. I shall have to show him. Oh, there they're calling. Listen. Oh, they're chasing each other. A bit of a dogfight going on here. Oh, they've left each other be. Okay, one of them's landed very close by here. Let's pull up the road here and have a look at him. There you are, David. You see him there in the tree? Well, let's see if he responds. He's very young. You see very mottled plumage. There's another one calling from way in the distance. That's a really delightful shot, actually, of a young fish eagle. When we say juvenile, I mean, he's obviously almost the size of an adult, if not the size of an adult, but he's just not mature yet. And I think they take about 5 years, if I'm not mistaken, to get to their adult plumage. And the other one is just a little bit older than this. Ooh, elephant. There's an elephant. In fact, there are a whole lot of elephants. There's some across there. This looks like a young bull in front of us. And there are actually a whole lot in the drainage line over there. Let's just watch this chap here because he's out in the open. And while we drive parallel with him, Dave, I'm just going to ask you, there's a huge fish eagle coming over the top of us here. There he is. Straight over the top of us. That's very cool. Alright, let's get in front of the... We'll get in front of the elephant so you can have a nice shot of him. I wonder if he's come along here thinking maybe there'll be something nice for me to drink. And there isn't. He's a young bull and I think he's a little irritated as well. I'm sure he's feeling the pressure of the drought and the lack of things to eat. So he's watching us. And that's what he was shaking his head at. Let's wait here. Hello, Debbie. You're asking me to do the impossible. You're asking me to try and predict the weather. You say, will there be any small rains before the big rains come? Debbie, it's possible. We've had one small rain already. And, you know, last year in September we had one big dumping of about 20 millimeters and then it just stopped altogether almost. So we might be lucky. We might get a little bit in September. And that's Arathusa Lodge that you're looking at. No, he's a young fellow. Ugh, ambling along. Hello, Marlene. You're wondering about the big rains and when we think they'll come. Well, you can wait as long as the end of November, Marlene. Could be as early as September. We've had a couple of bets on. I reckon the 10th of October is when we're going to get the first big sort of 20 millimeter storm. David, what do you think?
September 18th.
September the 18th. That was very definite, David. Do you know something? It's your birthday. Yes, well, that's a good day. Good day then for you. The 18th of September, David is convinced the deluge will begin. Perhaps he is correct. It would be very nice to get it that early, I must say. Let's go a little bit further forward. There's another elephant coming behind us, but I'm not going to... He's quite far away still. But there's a... seems to be a herd in the trees just up ahead. Ooh. This chap is now getting a little ornery with us. He came running at us, that's no good. Very cheeky. If it was a great big 35-year-old bull, we wouldn't be saying very cheeky, we'd be driving away at great speed. And While this elephant is being very cheeky, David, on the road in front of us, if you'd like, if you're getting... No, hang on a second, wait. Let's just keep on him for now. He doesn't like the sound of the car, I think. I think these elephants are getting more and more irritated. They're more... the further into the dry season we go. I think he's also a bit bored. Dave, just on the front of the road there, there is an elephant, but there's also, straight on in the front, there's some tiny little yellow birds, and they're yellow-fronted canaries. And they're rather special. Can you see them?
Yes.
Yeah, so you do. Yellow-fronted canary, everybody. We don't often get them in such glorious detail. I just love that colour. I think it's stunning. He's found a little bit of seed bed for him to dig in. That's what he's eating. Like a little finch. And if I'm not mistaken, the only canary species that we get here. Certainly the only one I've ever seen here. Isn't he great? Colour yellow, I suppose, quite a common pigment in the birds. I just think it's beautiful. That's sort of a custard yellow. I think rather than yellow-fronted canary, the custard-coloured canary would be a much better name. Don't you, Dave? The custard-coloured canary. Right, let's move forward. There is a nice herd of elephants in front of us. And while we move forward, we'll just watch this fellow, see if he decides to give us another rev. Now he's decided we weren't nearly terrified of him enough, so he's going to leave us alone. Now, as I've said to you before, David, of course, you can tell he's a male by the rounded front of his head. Can you see that?
Yes.
Yes. A little herd feeding in the bushes here. Hello, John Atmore. You ask a very good question. Just before I answer it, when you see a small breeding herd of elephants, i.e. one cow and one calf on the left-hand side, David, the first thing you should do is?
On the right-hand side.
Correct, which we've done, and assessed that there are not a whole lot of other elephants coming from the other side, so we can comfortably look at these two. John, you say, what would an African elephant herd accept into the herd an Indian or Asian elephant? And the answer, John, is probably not, but I don't know for sure. They are very kind of sympathetic, if you like, animals. They don't like the distress of other animals. And I wonder if an Asian elephant, which doesn't even belong to the same genus, so they're part of the same family. But I suppose you might think of them as being as distantly related to each other as leopards are from caracal or African wildcats. So they're even further related from each other than leopards and lions are. We know they don't really speak much. But I think elephants, because of their social structure, and this has certainly been proven in other matriarchal societies, have a slightly elevated sort of, I suppose, what we would term human intelligence. And so maybe they would adopt an African elephant, but a decent Indian elephant. I wonder if it hasn't happened. I don't think it's happened in the wild, but I wonder if it hasn't happened in captivity in these animal parks and that sort of thing. And I wonder if there aren't cases of African and Asian elephants living together. I'd love to know if anybody knows. Please let us know. Hashtag Safari Live Questions at WildEarth.tv if you happen to be on the email. That's a young calf. I mean, obviously calling this a breeding herd is a bit of a laugh because there's one cow and one calf. But strictly speaking, that's exactly what you would call it. And that calf is probably, as he has his little dust bath, about 4 years old, maybe. And just tossing some dust on him because I think they just like the feeling of it on their skin, you know. There might be some others further forward, you know, gone in front of them. But I'm not sure. I'm just watching behind us just to see our bull. He's not doing anything, he's just standing exactly where we left him. Let me sneak slightly forward so we can get a view of the mum. Everything out here seems really kind of soporific at the moment. They're all kind of very sleepy in this relatively hot afternoon. She's just picking, he's picking up a few leaves, possibly the odd pod that's been dropped. In fact, what are they eating though? Because that's not a tree they'd normally eat. You know, it's a gwari bush. I think that's one or two things that are growing underneath there. Oh, there's another species of tree there. It's a spikethorn. They're eating common spikethorn, or Gymnosporia buxifolia, which is pretty tannin-rich and very thorny, so I'm not sure they'd eat it unless they'd really feel like they had a choice. They're eating with slightly long teeth, I feel. Very nice. And she's thinking about having a suckle, I think, but she's probably slightly too old. Oops, I've managed to unplug myself. Sorry about that, Rebecca, if you've been trying to talk to me. I'm back in. That's interesting. Leslie in Seattle, this is wonderful. You say that in your zoo, you had a herd of three elephants, one African, two Asian, and you said the African was the dominant animal, but they got on with each other fine. That's wonderful. Thank you very much for that, Leslie. Let's head across to Steph, get an update from him. I'm going to continue on my quest to the south of Arathusa.
Welcome back, and you caught us trawling the cheetah cut line for whatever we can find at the moment. I'm hearing these sporadic updates on the radio from time to time that say that some guys are tracking some cheetah, although not in our particular traverse, very close by. And cheetah are one of those animals that will absolutely move during a hot day like this. They'll take a little bit of time off during the hottest time of the day, which here would have been around about 1 o'clock, 1-2 o'clock. But up until that point, they'd move around here, and you know, the chance to see cheetah, they move epically. And sorry, there's just something in the road there that caught my eye, and I'll let you know what it is. You can see what it is. There we go. Now, I see about exactly the same as that. That's what my eye is looking at now. Not only on the camera, but that's what I basically see. And you can see it looks like something was in the road there. Still looks like something is in the road there. But in actual fact, with a quick check on my binos, it's just a tree that's next to the road. The road curves around it. But yeah, I just wanted to come back to that pretty awesome Impala sighting that we shared a few minutes ago. For any of you out there I know you wouldn't have been guessing about this, but let me just make the statement anyway. That is how my luck works. My luck is literally getting up to a junction like we did, letting my hands go, and as we get close to the junction, feeling compelled to go in one direction or another, and then having a pretty amazing sighting from something arbitrary like that. Just these common things. That is how my luck goes. Brent, on the other hand, for those of you who don't know this, obviously has this amazing ability to dredge up incredible cat sightings from a whiff and a smoke and a hint of a track on the road. That, unfortunately, it's a skill that seems to have bypassed me in favor of these very weird, very special, very rare sightings like we had with that Impala. And for those of you who have just been watching a Safari Live for a short space of time, feel free to ask around the chat rooms and ask how many full-blown Impala fights have been seen like that over the years here. And you'll see that there'll be a handful. We've seen, I would say, dozens, perhaps even hundreds of cub events, which you'd think would be fairly rare. We see that much, much more common than we do Impala fights like we've just had. Another dwarf antelope here. Since we are on the dwarf antelope, there is a female Steenbok. I'm sure there's one in the open there. We've got a couple here. Just see the bum there. So that is a full-grown antelope, a female, lack of horns, you can just see there. Steenbok, S-T-E-E-N-B-O-K. And they are arid area specialists. They do incredibly well in bushveld like we have here. Them and the grey Duikers are probably, next to Impala, the most common of the antelope that we see, and usually running off at top speed. This one has found something of interest in the bushes there. They are browsers. They eat leaves. They don't eat grass. Something there has caught this little Steenbok's attention. There you go. Full grown and in quite good condition, I must be honest with you. This particular antelope doesn't have to drink water at all. It gets enough water from the vegetation that it eats. Can you believe, with all this virtual sand that we have here, it finds enough water not to have to drink. You find them in pairs. It's called a monogamous pair. However, the two of them are very rarely together in their tiny little territories. The males are almost always apart from the females. And I don't really know why. I haven't really read anything that says why, but it's probably to avoid detection. Being as small as what you are, or as what this particular antelope is, living in a bound territory doesn't give you many options when the lions come a-visiting. And I think the fact that the two of them are separated most of the time means that there's less chance for both of them being caught by a pride of lion or by a hunting pack of dogs or whatever it is that come through here. So for me, it's just a survival strategy. I don't think it's because they dislike one another until they have to mate and have a baby. But quite unique in terms of what they do, their specialization. They bury their dung, very similar to how a house cat does, in a litter box. They will scrape with their hoof, move over the scrape, defecate into the depression, and then they will turn around and scrape the sand over their feces again in an effort to mask the smell and therefore their presence in an area. In areas with lots of ant bear holes, they've also been known to have their babies underground and bury the leftovers. They eat the placenta, most animals do. And then they bury the fluid, or the birthing fluid, they bury with scraping their hooves over it. Once again, just to mask the scent of their presence in any particular area. So I feel quite justified in saying that the couple don't hate one another. They probably speak to one another or have some form of communication that doesn't require tangible reassurance thereof. They don't need to touch one another like hippos do, or warthog for that matter of fact, or any of the mongoose, or any of the monkeys out here. Oh, it's such a beautiful afternoon, actually. Coming back to this October discussion that I've had on and off now for the last 20 or 30 minutes or so. So animals will almost always be biased towards water. And as the distance between water or a water source and food becomes past the horizon that they can get to before they will dehydrate, animals stop feeding, or they reduce the amount of feeding that they do in any case, to a point where it becomes almost negligible. They will be around water points, moving a little bit further away from the water, a couple of hundred yards, and that's because at that particular point in time, lions almost inevitably camp out just near the water points and pick off those individuals too weak to run away. And they will literally conserve energy lying up in clumps around these watering points, just waiting for the rain to come. And by that point, it's usually around about October, the middle of October. Here, rain usually falls anywhere around about the 10th of October is when we'll have the first rains, but the first real serious rains will only sort of come at the end of October into November, where we'll see a flush of the grass and of all the leaves that that keep these animals sustained, and then it almost becomes a frenzy. From mid-November all the way through until the end of March, middle of April, it's just an absolute frenzy of activity. So let's take a wager on the official date that rain is going to happen here. All things considered, and you've been privy to a bunch of discussions amongst myself, James, and Brent and Jamie about what effect El Nino will have and what effect La Nina has, and are we moving from El Nino into La Nina? Some people have said that the last 30 years or so have been marked by flooding around every 10th year or so, around the end of every decade. Whereas the absolute driest times of the year have been marked by the middle of the decade. We're in 2016 now, so on the cusp of one of these dry, wet scenarios. I don't know, let's make a prediction here. I'm going to go with the 10th of October. Let's just hit the nail square on the middle of the head there. I'm going to say 10th of October, we're going to have our first significant rain, and I'm going to set range to that, the 20 mil range. So significant rain here is anything more than 20 millimeters of rain that falls within a 24-hour period. Ah, and Brian's on 20th of September. It's Paul Kruger's birthday, the 10th of October, and luck would have it that on Paul Kruger's birthday, Paul Kruger was a former president of South Africa and is who the Kruger National Park is named after. And that is sort of the mark that people give to rain in this particular area. So James and I are sticking to Paul Kruger's birthday. That's how you're supposed to say it, although you'll never really catch me doing that again. And I'll share it with James. We'll share the prize money, whatever it ends up being. All right, off we go. So we are on the hunt for a cheetah that was seen coming. I don't think it was seen coming into this area. It's definitely off our traverse, but definitely moving in this particular direction. And with the temperatures not being that hot at the moment, I would well imagine that cheetah that hasn't caught anything could quite easily come here. I mean, it's a couple of hundred yards, that's it. And we have seen cheetah exactly where we are before. Male cheetah definitely are also territorial, very similar to how lion and leopard are. And there's nothing that would prohibit a cheetah from coming through this area to refresh a scent mark or just visit an old haunt. Bless you. Brian having a sneeze with the dust kicked up by the wheels. It's also starting to get to that particular time of year where we need to start thinking of sunscreen to preserve our youth. Definitely I go through more sunscreen than what I do shampoo in any given period of time. The massive fin of a big nose that I have, and my forehead that tends to stretch. Oh, sorry, Brian. Has this particular white heat or white hot. It is such a winter sky that you're seeing there. So the August winds have kicked a bit of the dust into the atmosphere here, and the dust here is white. And what it does is it gives this milkiness, milky smudge to the horizon and to the sun. Lends itself to some pretty epic sunrises and sunsets that you've no doubt been sharing with everybody over the last couple of weeks. But it also sort of blurs out that beautiful blue that the sky has after a rainstorm or at the beginning of winter, those first few crisp mornings. So this dust that gradually builds up in the atmosphere, this dryness that builds up in the atmosphere, all heralds the rain. So Thomas, you've just asked me, or us at least anyway, you've just asked us how much rain we need to stave off the drought in any given summer or winter. We have a summer rainfall here. Summer for us is anywhere from about the 1st of November until the 31st of March, as per my definition of summer here. And generally, on an average year, we'll have about 450 mils of rain. That's about that much in any given year. Anything half of that, which is what we've had now, is considered a drought. Anything double that, so up to this much, is considered a very wet or flooding year. Now, in 2012, we had over 1,000 mils of rain. 1,000 millimeters of rain fell here, about 1,200 in actual fact. And in 2016, we had about less than 200 millimeters of rain that's fallen. So you can see that the mean range over a very short space of time is quite big. But when we look at average, and this is just statistically speaking, of course, Thomas, we have about 450 mils of rain in a year, and from that horizon we will decide plus or minus. As to are we actually in one of the worst droughts that this country's ever seen, I don't know. I really don't know. So excuse me with just breaking off my conversation there, but Erica, all the way from Latvia, hello Erica, you've just asked me a very interesting question and I really needed to hear all the details over there. You wanted to know, do we have extremes in weather here and things like wind and heat, I suppose, in terms of heat waves and snow and ice and tornadoes and hurricanes, and have I experienced any of those, and what is the worst weather that I've experienced here and what was it? So let's just start right at the beginning, Erica. We don't have any extreme weather conditions over here. South Africa is actually one of these pretty epic places that have very little geologically going on, so no volcanoes and earthquakes and mudslides, etc. And from a climatic point of view, we're also pretty stable. So we don't get things... Of course, there are anomalies and we do find tornadoes from time to time, and in very wet years, tail ends of hurricanes do give us an above average rainfall, but we don't have that sort of thing here as commonplace. We don't get very hot temperatures. I mean, although it peaks at about 50 degrees centigrade here in summertime, it's really just very localized to here, and it doesn't get very cold either. I think the coldest recorded temperature in South Africa is probably about it'll be in the teens in degrees centigrade. What it actually is, I'm not too sure. So we don't have those extremes. I must say, probably the worst weather that I experience here would be lightning. This area has some spectacular lightning storms and wind associated with those lightning storms. Nothing on a tornado or hurricane basis, but definitely lightning. And I've done game drives in the lightning, in the rain, trying to get home to base, of course, but sometimes you just get caught out there and you just have to weather the storm. And that's probably about the most extreme, the most violent, these huge crashes of lightning and thunder, literally over your head, striking trees close to where you are. You could smell the burning in the atmosphere. You can feel the electricity in the air. Of course, those massive crashes of sound associated with big lightning storms are always just impressive to hear. So that's probably about it. And I hope that answered your question. What type of weather do you get in Latvia? I suppose is an equally interesting question. It's one of these countries that you hear much about, but so very rarely see anything here in South Africa. We don't see sports teams coming from Latvia here. And we definitely have very, very few visitors here. That being said, I did once drive around a president, a lady president, Madame President, from Latvia, probably about 10 or 15 years ago, as a guest of mine. A very interesting experience, needless to say. All right, so now we're on one of these roads that are on the eastern side of Buffalsuk Dam, and I'm hopefully going to be approaching the dam from the eastern side, so from the Torchwood side. Let's see what is there. I would only imagine it's a little bit of green pond scum at the moment, made up of much algae and not much else. Here we've got a... What do you think has done this? Oh, obviously an elephant has pulled this tree out, it rubbing on it more than likely, and you can see that there's the root being pulled out. The tree itself now is bowed over the road and will present a significant obstacle for our aerial to go under. Luckily our aerials are all attached with bungee cords, and I'm hoping with just a little bit of coaxing we could probably go underneath the highest point. There we go. No harm done. Snap back up into place without so much as losing you for a split second. Now very close to where we are now is where the one lioness of the Nkuhuma pride had her cubs for a while. She had her den literally just in front of us in the termite mound. And it afforded us a couple of weeks, I don't think it was as much as 3 weeks, but definitely 2 weeks worth of viewing her from almost on top down onto this drainage line where she would lie and suckle her cubs. And they were still tiny when we saw them. They were just these little balls of fluff with their milky white eyes making their little mewling calls. Something so special to share, especially when you got access to it, you know. Alright, we are around about a minute or two from the watering hole. I don't quite know what to expect there. I'd hope to see that there was some elephant there, but we've seen so little sign of elephant at the moment. I'm almost convinced that elephants move around in these sort of loosely associated herds with one another. 6 to 8 elephants, sometimes as many as 12 elephants on their own, and always in touch with other elephants. We get these 2 or 3 families that will come through here at any given time, different families at different times. And I don't think that there is an elephant herd on Djuma at the moment. So Brian, you haven't seen elephants on Djuma for a day or two, eh?
Yeah, a couple of days.
Couple of days. So they've moved off and gone to feed somewhere else. That being said, there are elephant tracks all over the road here. Unfortunately, going away from the dam. Let me just keep my eyes open here. Right, I can see the torchwood that we are talking about in the background, covered in its red-billed buffalo weavers, another common thing around watering points. There's the sheen of the water in the distance. You'll see it coming into frame over my shoulders. And we have some buffaloes, all that I can see for now, but let's get a little bit closer so that we can see anything else there. Shame, these buffalo are starting to look so skinny. Alright, we're going to see if we can get into a nice place to view these buffalo, and they won't run away, but the warthog that James are with definitely will. We'll catch up in a bit.
Pigs. Why are you laughing, David?
It's just the way you said it. Yeah.
They are pigs, everybody. There are some warthogs. A sow and her 2 piglets. I must confess to you, everybody, there is no greater joy I have in the world than when the camera man is unable to contain himself. Good. So them be pigs. And they're going about their business, and do not believe anybody who tells you that a pig cannot cope with a drought. It is a patent untruth. These chaps are very healthy. They're fat. They're, well, not shiny, but they're full of mud. You can't see their hips. They're in very, very fine shape indeed. And I think this is very interesting, and I've said this to you before, but if you drive from here to Hoedspruit, you drive past a reserve that is a closed reserve, so it's not open to the Kruger. So it's, I think it's probably about 10,000 hectares or so, 24,000 acres. And if you drive along the road next to that reserve on the way to Hoedspruit, you will find warthogs that look like they've come out of Ethiopia circa the famine in the 1980s. Really horrible looking, sort of emaciated animals. And yet you come into this open system where nothing is managed really by people, so the predator numbers are able to regulate in accordance with the prey species numbers and vice versa. And you find these pigs here, and they look fantastic. David, they are pigs. There is nothing to laugh at. Your picture is shaking because the cameraman is unable to contain himself, everybody. Sorry about that. Nothing we can do. So I think that that's quite a lesson for us. And I'll tell you why. We're going to just try and drive a little... No, well, let's wait for them to disappear. I think it's quite interesting because on these smaller reserves, obviously the numbers of animals are often managed. And we think as human beings we know what's going on. This is evidence that we clearly have no idea. And I suspect what happens there is that the... David has got the giggles. I suspect... I'm going to drive forward, everybody. And so the shaking doesn't look like David giggling. It looks like my driving. But we think that we know what we're doing. And I suspect in these reserves what happens is that they manage the numbers of lions, for example, and they manage the number of cheetah and numbers of hyenas. Leopards, they don't really, because they don't really know how many leopards there are or where they are. But those three other major predators, they manage very carefully. And I think you find that they probably overmanage them. And that's why the warthogs have such a tough time. It's really, really been such an eye-opener to me this season. Now, it's round about here that Shadow was seen this morning, and I wondered if she wouldn't like some pig for her lunch. But she hasn't had any pig for lunch, as far as I can see. Tingana, of course, not too far from here yesterday, and he loves a good pig for lunch, David.